Orthogonal methods in detection. This to me is like a really important area, and because we're contract-based and we do depend on our customers to contract that with us, I wish that they would do it more. But and where we're in control, we do follow this practice. Orthogonal methods are intended as complementary to a given primary method. So if HPLC is your primary method for impurities, consider using TLC as an orthogonal method. Now, the scenario here is that you have a reverse phase method for LC, and then for TLC, you could use it in its classic normal phase mode. Imagine if an impurity is strongly retained on a column in reverse phase, it would come across as a highly mobile component in thin layer chromatography. And it's not only that element of difference, but also you could think of little orthogonal components to other things that you do already. Photodiode array and peak purity can help you look for the hidden impurity. If you really think about it, it's another approach to challenging the method or asking yourself, what could I be missing here? An alternate detection mode for the same technique. So you could hook on in tandem mass spec, and for projects we've worked on, there have been impurities that you can't see by UV detection, and by mass spec you can. So we have to deal with that. And I wanted to just say this is great insurance, and it's okay even if it's under the line data. So you could collect it. It may or may not have to be part of your specifications, but it should be part of your analytical package. So here's an example of something. So I actually have real data in this talk, right? Now, but this is an HPLC chromatogram, one component, and the middle lane of the thin layer chromatogram shows that there are two components. So that's just an example, something you could have missed. Force degradation, I will not get into this deep dive, but it represents a class of impurities, right? So your method has to be stability indicating as well as impurity indicating, the latter of which is what you typically use for release testing. Customers and really everybody likes to have a single method that covers impurities and degradation products. So we do a lot of these studies at Regis based on the nature of the work we do. And the most relevant force deg treatments pertain to what you see in real-time stability, namely thermal, humidity, and to some extent light. All the others are a lot more in the informational category, and they can be really useful for drug product developers. One case is where we know that we characterized a compound as highly acid labile, and about 2 months later, the customer said, you know, we're doing a dissolution study in simulated gastric fluid, and I see these two peaks. And right away, I looked at that, and I looked at my method development report, and said, this makes perfect sense. I know exactly what those compounds are. We proved it on MS, and I don't know what his strategy is going forward, this person I talk with, but they may have to do something different. I don't know if it involves enteric coating, and they let it get absorbed somewhere else so it doesn't degrade, but you can see the utility, I hope, of that information. So what do our customers expect? Well, it varies. Some of them have very little documentation, very little to provide us, and they want us to do all the work, and that's fine. That's what our capabilities are. And others have a lot of information. They say, do a minimal transfer, okay? Do a minimal method transfer, probably under protocol, and we'll have all these methods shown to be suitable for intended use, fit for intended purpose. Either way, the goal is to have analytical methodology as suitable and in step with the phase you're working in and the regulatory requirements. Our contract perspective is that we do need to know these things, okay? Methods and markers we have to have. Tests and specifications, you need to know your targets. You also need to know the phase of development. And if possible, they can inform you of what will be the target dosage type. Think about where this is being registered. Do we have to follow any USP methods, or do we have to follow any EP methods, or in some cases, BP methods, which I think were derived from Australia? Of course, client-specific information, things that are just unique to the customer. And safety. Cannot forget safety. Regis does what any good facility should provide. We have development summary reports, we have control test methods, and we have validation protocols plus reports. You certainly want to make that part of your analytical package. So I am winding down here on the slides, and I didn't know a good place to put this into the whole sequence of events, but you do have to have cleaning verification methods. We have a cleaning verification program, and with these slides, I'm just trying to get across the point that Regis does all the necessary swabbing studies, the spike recovery off surfaces. We have rinse sampling and so on. It's a whole topic in and of itself. But you want those methods to be sensitive so that you don't have cross-contamination. Sensitive and suitable. So my concluding comments are as follows. We want to have suitable methods, fit for intended purpose. We want to keep the analytical package current and phase appropriate. And we want to remember the guidelines, and ultimately you want to know your material. So the blank screen says we're done. Thanks. I'd be happy to entertain questions.
If possible, if you have a question, if I could pass the microphone to you so we could capture it on our film. So, if possible.
Paul, great presentation, thank you. You use the term in silico. I've never heard that term. Quick definition?
I always thought it meant computer-based.
Okay.
I just stole the term because I've seen it in documentation. I think it means like in silicon, like Silicon Valley, and I'm guessing that.
If you use then ICH, which need to be followed?
Oh, can you repeat the question, please?
If any X compound has a wider limit in USP and ICH has lower limit, which limits need to be followed?
You know, I'm going to venture to say you want to go with the more strict limit because, excuse me, that's kind of like the least common denominator of what you need to do if you want to register globally. I suppose. And again, I'm not the regulatory person to make those final decisions, but I would say if you really think you're going to limit your distribution to a certain region of the world, you might be able to get away with just that limit. I know that customers of ours have dealt with how they help us in setting specs for material that might go to US or EP or European distribution. So I think you always want to play it conservatively. That's what I would do personally. I would try to go with the more strict limit.
Say, Paul.
Yes.
You know, I was kind of surprised that we don't have these genome. What are they called? The ones that affect gene alterations. That.
Yeah, potentially genotoxic.
Genotoxic. That's it. I'm sorry. Anyway. It was on the basis of amounts, which really surprised. By the way, this is not my area. I mean, everything you talked about was great,
okay.
But they talked about amounts, and that really surprised me because obviously any compound is going to have more or less activity per weight. So how in the world do they get away with just requiring certain weights of impurities?
Well, this is a guideline. And it is, I would say it's still an emerging area of knowledge of what's going on. And it's pretty much recognized that a given impurity A and impurity B, they could be orders of magnitude different in their toxicities. And yet you follow that guideline and you want to tamp down those two impurities to less than, what was that number? 1.5 micrograms a day. And your methodology needs to reflect that. But in the reality, impurity B, what did I say, could be like 10 times more toxic, and so you're still in a bad situation. So it's not just analytical sensitivity alone and the guidelines that really should guarantee safety. There should also be the appropriate toxicity studies. And we know there's compounds out there that are just terribly toxic, and if something is just closely related to it, it could be as well. And the guidelines and what I've read seem to acknowledge that you just don't say that that table alone is everything that you're going to follow. I mean, it is a very good start, and it's very challenging because you got to get your analytical methods jacked up to be, again, 100 to 1,000 fold more sensitive, generally.
You know, you mentioned the, I'm sorry, Paul, you mentioned the Ames test in that regard as a functional test. And it, isn't there something newer now that, that's much more precise and quick, et cetera, than the Ames test?
Actually, the Ames test is still around. I think it's been a lot more formalized and automated. And I know that there's a number of different subtypes of it, and there's even the micro Ames. Now, I'm going to be I'm talking a little bit out of my zone here, but this is based on a discussion with a consultant in this area who knows that there's a battery of tests that you do, and it may not just be only the Ames test, but that's a start. Yeah. Yes.
With respect to Brian's question about the amounts, what the FDA is saying with that table is they don't want any more than the total amount of a genotoxic impurity exposure for a particular patient in a clinical trial. So that table was, the amount was based on how long the clinical trial is. So if the trial was shorter, then you could have that amount. But
right.
For each of those categories, if you calculate it, it has about the same amount of total exposure of a potential genotoxic impurity.
I know those numbers are something based on like one incidence of cancer, even possibly happening like 1 in 10 to the minus 5th or 10 to the minus 6th. It's in the document. So there are a lot of considerations that went in statistically, but still, from compound to compound, you can't just assume that everything is equally just okay or equally bad toxic, you know?
Obviously
not. Yeah, right. It's a good point. Yeah.
Yes, there are some special cases for like imaging agents that you just use one time for impurities, aren't there?
Well, and I think it really is like an extreme end of that spectrum where your dosing duration is extremely minimal.
Okay.
And so what you could tolerate would be a bigger number on that chart. And at the same time, a lot of these imaging agents tend to be delivered in extremely low quantities because they're very, well, they themselves are very productive or potent. So on a percentage basis, you could even justify that you can have more of an impurity, an unknown in there. But that judgment has to come from careful considerations of trying to know your impurities as best as possible. Does a given impurity flag as potentially genotoxic, or is it just considered to be a regular impurity? So it's not always easy to say in one sentence what you got to do. Other questions?
Sure. As well, which is that it's all dependent on the number of experimental protocols that you follow of whether or not
yes.
you can find certain impurities. And it's something you always have to keep in mind that something is there that you don't know is there.
No, I agree. I totally agree. And I bet that if you look at this area 10 years from now, we're going to look at today's criteria and the way we're thinking is pretty fairly primitive. And that's okay. I mean, that's how it has to go. So, yes, hi.
Yes, in the middle you have this table with validation, you know, preclinical phase one, phase two.
Yes.
There is, at the same time as validation for the lot, there is a different kind of validation for the clinical, you know, when they get the blood sample or urine samples. And now your compound is in a different matrix. And because they make compounds that are so potent and the amount is little, do you sometimes get involved helping the bioanalytical lab when they do the validation of their method to measure the compound in clinical samples when it requires a lot of sensitivity? Are you sometimes involved or
well,
no?
I think I really do understand your question. And that is, but what you're referring to is the area of metabolism and
yes.
looking at complex matrices like body fluids of all kinds. We don't get involved in that. We you could say we technically have the capability to do that because we have instrumentation to look at, well, you know, mass spec and HPLC. But we don't take those kind of samples. And it's really not been our area, and I think really we haven't been asked. I don't recall being asked to do that.
Because you can potentially see some, let's say, a biological lab struggling because they don't get enough sensitivity on a compound, and because they use whatever methods they're typically using with blood and urine, but you might have a method that's very sensitive to measure impurities in your compounds that they might be able to transfer in some ways to their problem.
Well, drug substance methods, when you're dealing with neat drug substance, and I think I'm understanding your question here, that those are the ideal methods, right? And so you could use it as a starting point. But now you then introduce matrix interferences and you ask yourself, well, first of all, am I lucky enough that everything moves out of the way so I could see that one compound? Usually that doesn't happen, okay? And that's why one resorts to techniques like LC mass spec to find that. Or you could also, I think, use radiological techniques to track the parent and metabolites. Okay, it's something that I know, having worked at an innovator organization in the past, we did use our drug substance methods as the springboard for metabolism methods, but recognizing detection modes might have to change. But at least your chromatography is common. And then when you get into the area of which you're talking about, so many new things could happen, and you might have to change your methodology to look at metabolites, which might have nothing in common with the profile you get from manufacturing impurities or even stability data. So it's very situational. Did that help?
Yeah, I was wondering if you sometimes get involved. So usually you
don't. No, we don't do that here.
We could.
I mean, I'd have to really, check on the whole bringing in a biologicals as samples, but it's been in our kind of file. Okay, well.
Any more questions? Well, I guess in closing, thank you very much, Paul.
Oh, well.
It was a great talk.
Thanks for coming, folks.
Yeah, and thank you everyone for coming out. Just to let you know, our technical folks are behind you from process research, process development, of course, analytical as well. Thanks again, Paul, and keep us in mind if projects come up where things need to be worked on analytically, process development-wise, we're more than willing and able to help. So, thank you.
Okay.